modification to stipulation, you have to be a natural born citizen, have lived in the United States at least for the last 14 years, and I face 35 age circumstances. That was important for me, it's the longest time I was. Seriously though, those are the qualifications, that's it. It has nothing else about being a felon, being not.
You can actually be president from jail.
No, I'm serious. Now, here's what I'm glad you said, they just brought them up. So, there are multiple cases that are coming against President Trump. So, folks may be saying, well, you know, let him get elected president, and then he can just basically forgive himself or something, or he can pardon himself. Pardon me for forgetting about pardoning. With this case in New York, no, he can't. So,
there's a lot of power in
the
case.
Yeah, the power to pardon only is for a federal situation. Now, the governor of the state of New York can pardon.
It should have intervened already to stop this judge. They had the power to do.
Same thing would go with the state of Georgia. The case in Georgia, he would not be able to pardon himself there. That would have to come from the governor of the state of Georgia.
I think these lawsuits were presented in such a manner because of that.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely, yeah. Oh, well, the state would have to do that. So, but for a federal offense or a federal crime, yes, the president can pardon for that. Now, at the state level, that is something that the governor is able to do, and the governor alone at this point. You know, this could appeal, it could go to the Supreme Court. I mean, this could go a lot.
And it should. It should.
So we have a lot yet to see. It's not over at all. It's just the actual trial part of it is, and how the verdict is there. And, you know, there's going to be an appeals process, but and until that time, we have to be sentencing, and that's 5 weeks away or so. I mean, we've got over a month.
Initially, they were talking about 3 months, all the pundits on TV. Like, Judge's not going to wait that long. He's going to use politically everything in his power to disrupt this election. But it says in Psalm 37, Fret not thyself because of evildoers, neither be envious against the workers of iniquity. For they shall soon be cut down like the grass, and wither as the green herb. There comes a time God says enough is enough. And we are getting to the place now where the more liberty that is given for the left and the progressives to do what they do to tolerate their intolerance, we are finding more and more our freedoms being removed, our livelihoods being destroyed, our borders wide open, homosexuals and transgenders taking over the narrative of this country, an entire month given over to their celebration for perversion. We are watching, of course, the decimation of women as far as sports are concerned and their livelihoods as well. We are watching under this president a weak economy, a weak international presence, wars and rumors of wars that have begun under his watch because of his weakness. And Josh, if we don't address these issues biblically, number one, we're going to find ourselves not understanding them and we'll fall for the narratives. Secondly, if the GOP simply makes a mantra out of Trump's name and not bring us back to the issues, then they're going to make a big mistake in this election as well.
That's a good point. I think that was a mistake that was made previously. It was. It was in even on the parts of the American people. Christians, you know, we've got to be very careful that we're not looking to a man, obviously. Trump is not the answer for the United States. Now, God can use him. Lord can use anybody, but...
No, he can't use the Joe Bidens. They're unrepentant. They're unwilling to follow.
Well, I was just thinking about Joe Biden.
They are evil in heart.
No, I was not thinking at all about him.
Say, this is important. We need to address that because God can use anyone. But he's not able to use everyone because they're unwilling to be used. That's why Trump needs to
say this.
Liable to the things and the ways of God and surround himself with true born-again spirit-filled people, not wishful speakers.
I agree. But from this perspective, God can use people like Joe Biden. He can use people like Joe Biden.
Like
he did bring about judgment.
Yeah.
But on God's right, he did bring about the waters of it.
You see his dumb ass coming on my side.
Judgment who came to them, but God will use the wicked kings of
were going. In other words, this allows sin to begin, sin by becoming exceedingly sinful in their lives, because sin has its consequence, lifting his hand of protection. But Josh, at the same time, God is merciful and he is good.
Oh, absolutely.
And there are still many in this country that not only love this country, but love God. And I don't believe God is going to see them suffer.
God is going to take care of them. Here's the thing, and it would be very similar to when that happened in Egypt. The Lord protected them as he did. The plagues of the Egyptians did not impact the Hebrews like it did the Egyptians, of course. Now the death angel passing over would impact everybody. But the plagues that came, the land, the Goshen, the area that God's people were, they were separated. But still, there was an impact.
Of course there was.
Right, when we are in this war, we're not of this war, we're in this war. So the economy suffers. We're going to feel it to some degree. Now, that doesn't mean it's going to destroy us. But let's not confuse destruction with this, but there's still an impact. So we're going to see, but even then, to watch our nation, I don't need to see America go down this road. And whether I'm impacted directly or not, to see our country move in a direction that is the way it's been going, it breaks my heart. I don't want to see that. Even if it doesn't directly or whatever impact, I don't want to see it. And so we should care. It shouldn't just be, well, I'm not a no. We should care because there's a lot of people, a lot of souls.
Let me ask you this. What do you read, even from places like the Christian Post and the surveys that were done, right, and the attitude of the young people? We're seeing the move from dispensationalism to homomorphism, post-modernism.
They don't know what they do.
But what I'm saying is we're seeing less and less impact of sound doctrine in the church today than ever in my lifetime. Yet we've had the biggest movements. We've even named what the whole idea of church growth that represents, called missiology, the study of church growth. It's a modern word trying to explain something that's been followed for centuries, supposedly. But we're watching all of these so-called organizations and denominations. What impact have they really made on the hearts of individuals? Because really, society as a macro is a representation of the individual.
They can't impact the heart because only the gospel can do that. Only the gospel can cut deep into the heart.
So what you're saying, the gospel's not being preached.
No, because the cross is not being preached. The message of the cross is the gospel. It's not being preached.
Isn't it ironic that every vein of the prosperity gospel and the purpose driven by mixed itself with psychology into the church?
Yeah, you said the right word, vain. Both capacities.
And here's the thing, of that, we see less prosperity than we've ever seen for the majority of people. We see more lawlessness of the people instead of more righteousness as far as living and actions. So the very opposite of what they claim to be doing is happening, which is what I said from the beginning. These movements aren't of God. And now we've got Christian counseling or biblical counseling, which is a joke. I've been reading the material surrounding it. There's really no creature known as biblical counseling. Now, we could say, you and I are just talking about the modern biblical counseling, but the way they define it is different than the time we live in that today. But that thing has overtaken the church, the evangelical church, and it's taken over the denominational church. It's taken over the Pentecostal. It's just a rebranding of psychology using Christian terminology. But it's all works-oriented.
The church needs to
repent. And this whole leadership network has also infiltrated the church. We've got people studying leadership, and it's all based on Peter Drucker's principles and foundational thoughts, and C. Peter Wagner and these others. And yet, we have degrees, people going out and getting degrees in leadership. The Holy Spirit leads the church. Jesus Christ is the head of the church, and he calls people, and he's given us his word. That is sufficient for the believer, for the individual that's a minister, to preach the word of God. Peter, or I should say, Paul would tell Timothy in verse 15 of chapter 3 of 2 Peter, and from a child thou hast known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. Because all scripture
been other things. It's been these programs, it's been the church, it's been themselves, their works, but it's not.
So the message of the cross is the apostolic message of the hour. I believe that because it cuts through and it divides that which is false.
Exposes
and reveals that which is true.
The answer has always, it always has been, and it is, Jesus Christ. That's the answer. What Jesus Christ did at the cross. What did he do at the cross? Everything. Everything. Everything was done at Calvary.
Jesus said, all power has been given unto me both in heaven and in earth. He's all powerful. He can meet every need. Don't fret over what happened to Donald Trump. You watch what God wanted to do. Let's believe him for his miracles. God bless you.
Charles Broughton Stern, and you were just so pleased and happy to have you with us that I want you to know. We went up there with the previous program, and Dr. Goodfrey was relaying something about years ago that I think we need here, and you can start over if you want to.
Well, I was sharing that I was one of those who knew Jesus as a child. That's all I've done. I grew up in church. But in the Baptist church where I was raised, and our pastor, we didn't know anything about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. We didn't know anything about what we're talking about. We did talk about life in the Spirit. But we knew transformational salvation through the completed work of Jesus. We believed and preached every sermon was on salvation. Well, our pastor, thankfully, did not preach against it the way some did. See, back in those days, people preached what talks us up and down. We never did that. So when it came to the baptism of the Holy Spirit, now, later on, when I went to an Earl Roberts tent meeting and we got healed and went back to church, they did ask us to leave. But we also fired the pastor, because the pastor believed in the work of the Holy Spirit. Oh yeah, they keep us out, and we have built the church.
Miracles of God, and good, they had to be
ability of God to see that result. So that's, there are people of the Reformed camp, there are people of the Baptist camp, they may not be able to say publicly what they, that they believe it, but they know that it's real, they know it's real. But now, I, of course, will say, just, you know, come on over completely, let's pray, and you can be baptized in the Holy Spirit. I said, let me pray for you. And he was like, no, I can't do that.
You know what's important is not necessarily where we came from, but each tradition, the Pentecostal movement and the Reformed, if I can use that as a divide line, both are telling people what the Holy Spirit doesn't do.
Yes.
What the Holy Spirit can't do, what he won't. Instead of telling us what the Holy Spirit does do.
That's it.
And this is what the message of the cross, and I've talked about this for 10, 15 years. This is what I'm so excited about, is that we finally get to tell people when you're born again, this is what the Holy Spirit can do, bring you victory over sin in your life, and that on a consistent measure with the right object of faith and the power of the Holy Spirit to send you out to testify to Jesus. The spirit of prophecy is the testimony of Jesus. We want people to be able to hear and understand and grasp the truth of Christ towards them, and our work can be helped by the Holy Spirit. So we've got to stop telling people what the Holy Spirit doesn't do, what he can't do, what he won't do until you get, or until you do. If your faith is in Christ and you're pursuing what he wants you to pursue, he will bring you to the baptism of the Holy Spirit. As a Pentecostal, you better not leave behind what you had initially. And that's what we've done as a Pentecostal movement.
See, I think that was one thing our pastor didn't tell us against.
Yeah.
He didn't know just
yeah.
the homework.
Yeah.
So he wasn't limiting God. Would it be a fair statement to say the biggest thing that hinders the Holy Spirit from working in our lives is us?
Of course, but again, if you're brought up in a tradition that teaches you not to believe in the work of the Holy Spirit, whether you're a Pentecostal telling believers you can't have victory over sin until you're baptized with the Holy Spirit,
or you're a requisite that you took many times, but you took that last drink of alcohol.
Yeah.
There.
You bet. I did.
And what happened?
Well, it wasn't just the last drink. It was the last line of cocaine. It was the last rolling of the joints.
You've been saved now for several weeks.
I've been saved for several weeks, and these things dropped off little by little. And within 90 days, the externals that had been so hurtful and bound to such a degree, from smoking the 2 packs a day and the Copenhagen and the pills and all the rest of it, those externals were eliminated. And it was another 3 months after that before I was baptized with the Holy Spirit.
But the Spirit of God worked in your heart and life. That's
the only one who could have delivered me from that. And every single born-again believer has that capability. That's what we need to teach.
You were delivered from nicotine. A dear lady sitting very close to you in church on a Sunday morning gave an utterance in tongues.
Right. That is true. I came into the presence of a Pentecostal denomination, but I wasn't baptized with the Holy Spirit.
At that time?
No, it took another 3 months before I was actually baptized, but it was that day that the work of the Holy Spirit that I received in salvation manifested itself in freedom from cigarettes. So, don't tell people what the Holy Spirit cannot do in them. Don't do that. He's not limited. He's only limited by our faith. And when we, as Pentecostals, say, well, he doesn't do that until you're baptized, we're limiting people. We're hurting people. And when we tell people the Holy Spirit doesn't do that anymore, we're hurting people. And we're hurting the work of God.
I hope this builds.
Stop.
I hope this builds for nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I will not trust the sweetest man, but only lean on that dear hand. On Christ the Son, rock I stand. All else is sinking sand. All else is sinking sand. When the person gets saved, what our dear brother wrote some 300, 400 years ago. It holds true in their life immediately when they eat the prize.
Well, on that spring day of 1966, under that Oral Roberts Camp meeting, when I was healed, not one member of my family was baptized with the Holy Ghost. Not one. But we knew that God could do something. But we didn't know what he was going to do or how he was going to do. But we were open to letting him move in our lives.
Right. So what did we baptize with the Holy Spirit? You were saying that at an age you don't even understand because it was so young.
Yeah.
But your church then transitioned from a Baptist church. What did you encounter?
I actually got baptized with the Holy Spirit with the initial evidence of speaking in tongues at age 13, 2 years later. It took that long. And it was funny because I was one of those that you preached in the church many times. It was a large church in Atlanta that you used to preach in. Assembly of God. But I went to the altar seeking the baptism of the Holy Ghost. I was probably baptized 12. And I'm praying, God, give me the Holy Ghost, give me the Holy Ghost. You ought to know how to do it, man. That's all we knew how to do at the time. And the more you know, the better you bet, the quicker God's going to move in your life. That's all we knew. We were ignorant. But our ignorance was innocent and pure towards God. And it was still ignorance.
Yeah. I heard a brother there from the preaching in Africa. There might have been a lot of people drunk in the Holy Spirit. Actually, one of the missionaries told me that most all of the people baptized the Holy Spirit. At this particular time, in the city of Exodus, there is a study written for the believers. It is the story of the new covenant, and it is, I think, the single most important material of this era. I believe that this book, some 650 pages of what it holds, will help you to understand the new covenant. The message of the cross, what Jesus meant to process nothing else will. It sells normally for $40, on sale for just $20 plus shipping and handling. Every believer needs to understand what the new covenant is. Every believer needs to understand the message of the cross. This will help you to understand it, I think it's done. And this is Jesus where you're saying, I am waiting for your goal. For more information on this offer, go to shopjsn.org. We're talking about begging God. That's all he knew to do. Brother Charles said that he was just about all of the pastors and five different countries in Africa. Under his ministry, the Holy Spirit. And he said they would come down to the altars and start saying, I beg you, God, I beg you, God, I beg you, God. He said, one day I told him, you don't have to do that. He wants to do it. You don't have to beg him. He said, then look at me. Turn my back around, start all over again. I love you, God. I beg you, God. He said, the only difference was they were filled with the Spirit. They would go through to the Holy Spirit. So finally, the Lord said, you just shut up, believe me, Mom.
It's funny.
Early days, that's all we knew.
Yes. When I first learned of the Pentecostal gifts and the Pentecostal atmosphere, the little church God led me to, wonderful place to grow up as a Christian, we had prayer meeting every single night. It was at 6 o'clock. And most of the time, there would have been 3, 4, 5 people there, maybe. And I remember time and time again after I was seeking the baptism. So I just figured the louder I prayed, the closer I was going to get to it. And we get up front and start praying and praying and praying. I'm carrying on and carrying on. And I'll never forget one of the brothers come up to me afterwards and he said, man, I thought for sure you were going to get it tonight, but you were really close. But it was all based on loudness or begging or all of that. And when I was ultimately filled, it was in the exact opposite manner than I ever thought it would happen. fellow that was with me said, I want to pray for you. And I'm like, and so he laid hands on me in about 10 seconds, just quietly and soft. You know, I kind of thought God was going to have to take my tongue and wag it for me and throw me down on the ground and I'd wiggle and shout. And instead, here came just softly. And well, you know, I didn't care. I just wanted it. Wiggle and shout. Haven't you ever been to a Pentecostal church? Wiggle and shout. But then I got this. Anyway, so I came through. What was funny was that I'm just standing there quietly.
Say that, Lord.
What you're hearing is the Holy Spirit giving the utterance. He won't speak for you. He won't do anything for you. He wants you to be filled. You're the one who needs to be filled. And those words that you hear are speaking now. Did you hear what I said?
said.
Yes, sir.
Those words that you hear and your spirit start speaking them right now as we will pray for you. The Lord wants to save you. He loves you.
Yes.
Praise God. He wants you to have the mighty baptism with the Holy Spirit. And what Jesus did at Calvary's cross made it possible. Because before that they couldn't be, but after he died on the cross to atone for all sin, that made it possible for the Holy Spirit to come into your heart and life in power and service. Now let us pray, dear God in heaven, we come to you in the name of Jesus.
Yes,
we thank you for the mighty Holy Spirit. Praise God, there's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place. And I know that it is the presence of the Lord. I'm asking for that man or woman that wants the Holy Spirit, that boy, that girl. Lord, right that you will start to flow through their heart and through their life, and that they will be filled. Now go ahead and start speaking in the name of Jesus. What you hear was in your spirit. It is my man. Blessed be his name. For he has given peace, perfect peace to me. It is my man. Blessed be his name. Mine through all eternity. God's abiding peace is in my heart today. And I feel it now, yes, I feel it now. He has taken all of my doubts and fears away. And though I cannot tell you how, it's written in my heart. It is mine, it's yours. Jesus paid for it at Calvary's cross. Glory to God. And he has filled millions and millions, and he's filling you right now. Go ahead and speak it, as I've said, the words that you hear in your own heart right now. Start speaking them. Start saying them. The Holy Spirit won't force you. He won't say them for you. He'll give the utterance. But he will not do the speaking. That's you. Be filled with the Holy Spirit in the name of Jesus Christ. Glory to God. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
As the psalm says, come Holy Spirit, love on me. By your anointing, set me free. Pour out new wine on this thirsty heart of mine. Come, Holy Spirit, move on me.
Come, Holy Spirit, move on me.
By your
anointing, set me free. Pour out new wine on this thirsty heart of mine. Come, Holy Spirit. And he'll move on you. He's doing it. He's doing it right now. Praise God. Glory to God. And don't be ashamed to tell somebody that you've been baptized with the Holy Spirit. Praise the name of Jesus. Glory to God. And there's nothing like it other than salvation.
I'm sorry. What I was just simply going to say is that you don't have to be a pastor.
No.
You're called into ministry. My wife, if I asked her to come here and speak to us on a set or in front of a group, I'd have to come live with you for a while because that's just not what I'm going to do.
But that's all right. Please go ahead and do what you said.
But what I wanted to share with the people was, as a mom baptized with the Holy Spirit, she's been responsible for raising four children, all of which are doing work of God in the ministry. Joseph, Grace, Rachel, Joy, all four of them. And this is an anointing that rests on her that I don't have. But it's for service, it's for bringing people into the knowledge and recognition of Christ.
Thanks, God. Yes.
And God's given her that.
Yes.
ducks. We run out of time. Thank you for having me with us. And God bless you. The Book of Romans is, I think, one of the greatest books in the entire general Word of God. And it might just be the greatest. These two books that we're offering will help you understand it, I think, a little better. This one is entitled, God's Answer to Fear, Depression, and Discouragement. Every believer needs this book based on the great Book of Romans. And then second, The Great Commission. Every Christian needs to read this as well. Now, these are $15 each, even the one that you want. But I would advise you to get both of them and save even more money. $25 for both of them. It'll help you to understand the Word of God. Get these books and let them be a blessing to you.
For more information on this offer, go to shopjsn.org.
Lineup today. You are welcome, Josh Rosenstern.
Good morning, Greg.
to be here.
It is great to be here. I want to remind everyone of a couple things. First of all, the JSPC Summer Courses are happening right now. We're just a little under a week away from the rest of the day to watch how to study the Bible. So if you want to register for that class, go to www.jsbc.edu. It's only $50 for the whole week. So make sure that you go and register right now. We are limited in space, so you don't want to be caught out and left out. You want to make sure that you register now. Also, we've got an International Youth Conference coming up. And I can't believe it's only a couple months away. This is geared towards kids and teens, the next generation. That's what IYC is all about. And so you want to go ahead and register for JSM IYC. All the information is on the screen. Don't wait. I mean, it has been a blessing the past couple of years, and this is something you do not want to miss. It doesn't matter if you're 6, 7, 8, or if you're 15, 16, 17. Parents, grandparents, you need to get your kids down here. Youth pastors, children's pastors, you need to get your whole church down right here at Baton Rouge for IYC at the end of July.
Yeah, let me echo that. These youth camps could well do prove out in some lives to be the difference between spiritual life and spiritual death for these young people. I'm not going to take the time to recount some of the heartbreaking stories that we've been made aware of. On Monday will be the Democratic Republic of the Congo, and we've never done the DRC before, but this is what's amazing about it. It's a French-speaking country, and we're going to be introducing in the Congo, for the first time, our brand new French language edition of the Expositor Study Bible. And now, normally when we introduce a new version, we have a copy to hold up to it, but this is so good. We're literally, it's at the printers right now, and literally when it's printed, it will be loaded on a ship and shipped over to the Congo immediately. So it's going from printer to shipping to distribution, all in one fell swoop. And so we're excited about that. That's another language that we've added to all we've got. Besides English, we've got Portuguese, we've got Spanish, we've got German, we've got Russian, and now we've got French. And very soon we'll be finished with our Vietnamese and our Hmong language edition. So this is something to shout about. And then to show you the demand for the French Bible, after we finish the DRC, the Democratic Republic of Congo, which we won't finish it on, well, I hope we will, by faith, on Monday, but probably have to carry it over. But the next country after that is France. 12,500, and then after that, Gabon, which is another French-speaking country in Africa. So we're excited about this. Phone lines are open, as we get ready to go into our Bible study today. But if you, as we've done all week, if you are had trouble getting calls in before because of the volume, now is a great opportunity. So we are opening the phone lines, and as soon as we come back from prayer and the break, we will be taking your phone calls for questions or comments. But one last thing, I was at Dad's house this morning before I came over, and he is improving, but it's still going to be a while. Hopefully, maybe Mother can be here next week for the programs. She's going to try. I'll know more later this week because I won't be here next week. And so we don't like to run reruns, but sometimes we have to. So it'll be a rerun, or she'll be here, and she'll get dressed, come in, do this, and go right back off again. But we're keeping in prayer, and it is a very slow recovery. We are in verse number 11, chapter 3 of 1 Peter. Peter has been dealing with Christian conduct. First, he dealt with slaves and the attitude and the conduct that they should exhibit in even though they were slaves, and even though they may have a master.
Stealing the children from what?
And then
born in it.
To the wife's responsibility to the Christian husband, and then the
abandoned in it.
To the Christian wife, and now he's just dealing with
they just are getting out the dope.
As speaks to all, male and female. And in verse 10 yesterday, and we read that what Peter wrote, to refrain our tongue from evil. That's backbiting. That is attacking someone that has attacked you, and using your tongue to assassinate their character, or to invoke an argument, or whatever the case may be. And then verse 11, he says, let him eschew evil and do good. Let him seek peace and ensue it. The first part of that, let him ensue evil, just simply means that we're not to do wrong against anyone, no matter what's been done against us. We're not to render evil for evil, but we are to render good for their evil. In other words, our life and our conduct is to be different than that of the world. We're not to look at striking back when someone does something against us. We are to put them in the hands of the Lord. And, you know, that is the nature. That is the nature of the world, the get back, to strike back. Now, I want to make one quick clarification, though. This doesn't infer, some have tried to use this, let him shoot evil, to mean that nations aren't to defend themselves, or we're not to defend ourselves from violent harm. That's not what Peter is dealing with here. He's dealing with our everyday exchange in the marketplace as we come across people. You know, there's just some people that wants to bark at us. There's just some things that rub people the wrong way that we don't even know, and they're going to let you know that whatever the case may be. Or it can be a personal thing or whatever the situation. That's what he's talking about. If we didn't stand up against evil, then we would have a nation that is in the midst of anarchy. Well, and let me just say this. We are a nation that is suffering anarchy right now in many of our major cities because of district attorneys that will not prosecute criminals. I mean, I just read, I was reading this morning, one place, an illegal immigrant that killed a police officer, and he was not in a shootout or anything, but it was a car wreck. Was high when they did it. He was, the state asked for $1 million bond. The judge, not 90% of it all, he just said $100,000. That's anarchy. When we don't enforce the laws of the land, when we favor the criminal, the violent, over the victim. We are a nation that has lost its moral compass. It is not moral what they're doing, it is immoral. You don't reward crime by doing nothing. There has to be a consequence for someone's action. So he's not meaning that, but he's meaning in personal relationships. Then he said, and do good. Well, that's just obvious. And we are to do good wherever that we can. You know, Solomon, we read it yesterday. I'll read it again. Solomon, in concluding the book of Ecclesiastes in chapter 12, he said, fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. And so, as a Christian, our first desire in every situation is to do good. And if that's not your desire and motive, then you think you're saved, and maybe you need to get saved. But as a child of God, our first desire in every situation would be to let our life and our actions be a reflection of that which is good. Let him seek peace and ensue it. And that just simply means that doing everything in your power of action that favors peace. That's all it means. Keeping the peace. That's the whole idea. And you know, a lot of family conflicts and a lot of personal conflicts could be resolved very quickly if a especially if one is a Christian, if they would just turn the other cheek. If they would seek to respond to evil by doing good. And it saves a lot of problems. Now, like, once again, that doesn't mean that you let people roll over you. It doesn't mean that you let people bully you. But at the same time, it means that we will not go as far as they go. I mean, if somebody hits me, I'm not going to stand there and say, oh, why don't you just hit me again? You know, I'm going to defend myself, but only to defend myself. I don't want anger to get into it. I don't want to get the upper hand and then say, you did this to me, so let me show you what I'm going to do to you. That's not what I'm talking about. Then he said in verse 12, for the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous, and his ears are open unto their prayers. But the face of the Lord is against them that do evil. Let's look at the first part. For the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous. That word over there literally means upon. So it reads, for the eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous. Which means that as a child of God, the Lord, every single moment of your life, is intently watching over you. I preached a while back at Family Worship Center out of the deliverance of the children of Israel, and I brought up the verse, you know, where God said, I have seen the afflictions of my people. God sees his children. Nothing that happens to a child of God gets by the view of our Lord and Savior. So that means that every weapon brought against you, and I use a weapon, I'm not speaking literal weapons, I mean whatever the world would bring against you, whether it's slander, whether it's gossip, whatever the case, or whatever anyone that is evil that is done against you, the Lord takes note of it. And he not only takes note of what is done to you, but he takes note of the one who did it as well. And when that person, if they are not saved, well, they will be judged on that at the great white throne judgment. If they are saved and they haven't repented and made it right with you, well, they're going to lose reward when they stand before the Lord at the judgment seat of Christ. And they said that his ears are open under their prayers. And Kenneth Weiss said this on this statement. He said, and his ears are open unto their prayers. Once again, gives us a means by which prayer can be entered. Unto is literally into. God's ears are into the prayers of the righteous. What a picture, he said, of God bending down into the very prayers of his children, earnestly listening to our petitions, eager to answer us and come to the aid of all who pray. We have no far-off deity that we are serving, but he is ever near. We do not have to plead with God to make him willing to answer our prayers. In fact, he is more desirous of answering them than we are to have them answered. What a statement here. Then he said, but the face of the Lord is against them that do evil. It literally means that those who come against the child of God with evil intent, that the Lord sets his face against them. Once again, let me remind you, that's why Scripture says, vengeance is mine, says the Lord, and I will repay. So he is the one that carries out the vengeance. Not us. We are to be a reflection of Christ. And well, that is, you know, if somebody is really coming on to you and haranguing you and harassing you, it's hard. But we are to every situation to do our best to be a reflection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he marks what these sinners are doing. He takes note of what they're doing. There's nothing that gets by his sight as it regards the children of asking, Lord, that you would take this word to the hearts of the people. And I pray that it is helping them, that they're growing from it, and fruit would come. And as well, Lord, we bring the needs of the people before you. We ask that you would meet those needs in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Amen. We'll be right back after the break. The phone lines are open. So if you have a question or comment, 800-342-8430. 800-342-8430. Or you can email your question or comment to onair@jsm.org.
Truth. Sometimes it's hard to find. That's why there's Francis and Friends.
From Jimmy Swaggart Ministries, this is the Sunrise Broadcasting Network.
Ladies and gentlemen, these are DVDs that every one of you need. The truth about Catholicism. The truth about Islam. The truth about Common Core. The truth about Seventh-day Adventists. An expose on the religion of Islam. The truth about Freemasons. The truth about Mormonism, the truth about Jehovah's Witness. Now, these normally sell for some $30 each, but we reduce the price $10 each. Get one, get two, get five, get all of them, ladies and gentlemen. That's what you ought to do. You, as a believer, need to know what these religions stand for, what they teach. This is Jimmy Swaggart saying, thank you for hearing me out, and thank you for taking advantage of this. You'll be glad you did.
Take advantage of this offer by calling or going online at shopjsm.org.
If you're looking for a great school in Baton Rouge, we'd like you to consider Family Christian Academy. Tuition costs are very competitive. FCA offers the Abeka curriculum for K-4 through 5th grade and does not teach Common Core. FCA is an ACT testing site and offers honors and advanced placement courses. Discover Family Christian Academy. Call 225-768-3026 or visit fcacademy.net.
It's Family Worship Center singer Tara Bontman and her first recorded CD, Come See a Man. Christians are called to worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. And that's exactly what you'll do with this CD from Tara Bontman. As you listen to this CD, you'll feel the anointing of the Holy Spirit.
Should not have been Biden or Trump supporters. teachers that didn't vote. Which I don't like people not voting, but that's really the best way, because that's probably the only 12 that would not have an animus in this. But I have been reading after several legal scholars this morning, even those that are not conservative, they've all said this is going to be overturned on appeal because, and they begin to list all of the mistakes that the judge made. And so, but anyway, it is a detriment to our government and our country, because if they can do this to a former sitting president, they can do it to you. They can do it to you. Like one legal analyst said, he says, I'm still trying to figure out what the charges were, what the purpose of the case was, because he was brought up on something that had never been tried before. But, you know, we, as a Christian, if you're a supporter of Donald Trump, I wouldn't go moaning and groaning and losing sleep over it, because there's another step ahead, and hopefully it would place in the hands of people that are doing their best to abide by the law. And if they are, then this will be thrown out. But in the second hand, one thing you should rejoice, he has raised millions of dollars. His servers crashed last night. After the verdict was in, people went online to give so much money, his servers crashed. Secondly, one CNN analyst said, I think that they just helped get Trump elected in November. So we don't need to moan or groan, or we don't need to exalt in exuberance, because if you're against them, because it ain't over. It's not over. All right, our first email today, this morning on the Message of the Cross, that had to be a rerun. Rose Swagger stated, what happened to Christ on the cross was terrible. I do not agree with that statement. Christ gave us the greatest gift of life. And, okay, I'm not going to read the rest of it. You completely misunderstood, because he's made this statement many times before, what was being said. Number one, what was terrible about it was what he endured. We cannot comprehend the suffering. Physically, mentally, emotionally, that was terrible. To have to literally have large chunks of your face, of your beard, jerked out. To have a crown of thorns. To the lictor's lash. To be nailed to the cross. This was terrible pain beyond what any of us can ever imagine. Secondly, it was terrible what the nation of Israel and the spiritual leaders did. That was terrible. It was horrible. And they're paying the price for that today. And the list could go on and on. You're not understanding it in the context. It was wonderful and glorious for us. But somebody had to die.
With what most theologians believe is 39 lashes,
they laid a cloak on him and then ripped that cloak off of his back. Just that right there would have been excruciating, not including everything else. So, yes, it's good. But in that moment, Christ himself in the Garden of Gethsemane was saying, God, if there's any other way, let this cup pass.
You know, only one historian writing of speaking of Christmas Christ, not speaking of it from a spiritual point of view, but bringing out some historical facts. He was a Christian, but he was a history guy. He said it was customary in the Roman culture that day that the whip that they used, they just didn't have leather thongs, but they would take and cut holes through the strap and embed sharp rocks and other objects so that when that lictor's lash would hit the back, eventually those rocks or sharp stones would cut into the skin, and they wouldn't just hit and then pull it back. They would hit and then drag it down. And so he said it's quite possible when these 39 lashes were given that his back was laid open like raw meat. And he said it was beyond a whipping that we see on TV, and that's horrible in itself. But it was much more because the Romans were cruel people in their punishment. They were very cruel. So you're not, as I said, you're not understanding. It was a terrible price and a terrible ordeal that he endured that we may rejoice and have a positive benefit from it. But we can never, ever gloss over the sufferings that Christ endured. Hey, what is sufferings that redeemed us? It was his death and his resurrection. But yet, those sufferings were a part of it. And when he said he was touched with the feeling of our infirmity, that's part of what it meant when we hurt. When our body is racked with physical pain, he can identify with it because he went through physical pain as well. So I hope that helps you answer the question. If it doesn't, be sure and email us back and we'll discuss it a little bit.
Just add one thought on this. We know that the wages of sin is death, separating us from man from God. We have to always remember this. On the cross, Jesus cried out and said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And we can figuratively say it this way. The worst part of sin was experienced on the cross. Now, Jesus Christ was not a sinner. He was perfect. And he was the sacrifice for sin. But that means he took the full judgment of knowing the physical suffering, as we've talked about here, was unbelievable. But for a period of time, as darkness covered the face of the earth, Jesus Christ experienced the worst part of sin, which is what those in hell will suffer for eternity, and that is complete and total separation regarding relationship.
That's one thing I've got to bring out on that cross. There was a separation.
Right.
The Bible said that God the Father would not even look down.
Right.
And that was
awful.
That was the emotional side.
Oh, absolutely.
Of someone that for 33 and a half years had always felt the presence of his Heavenly Father and the Holy Spirit. And yet, on that cross, he did not for a season or for a time there, not the entirety, but for a time. And he felt our lostness. And he felt our sin. And that is well, really, we don't, the word terrible is not even, there's not really a word in any language that can really state or elucidate all that Christ felt, because it was physical / spiritual. And we have no concept of that spiritual, none whatsoever. And so that's what is being meant there. So as I said, though, if there's more questions on that, be sure to email us back, and we'll continue the conversation. Barry from Virginia, you're on the air. Hello, Barry. What's your question or comment today?
Yes, I'd like to know, the horseman in Revelation, is that anything to do with say it's directly relating to Islam in and of itself, but I do think the Islamic world will be participating in cooperation with the Antichrist. And much of their eschatology or end time events, they do deal with issues of the Islamic world taking over the world for the sake of Islam, and many are actually trying to put that in practice today. It's called the Dawah, the spreading of Islam throughout the world. But we don't ignore that, because the Antichrist himself, and we can see from some scriptures in the book of Daniel as well, the activities he's going to participate, the leadership that he's going to take, he's going to have to get the respect and the admiration of others, including the Islamic world, which represents over 1 billion followers. So it doesn't ignore them, but does it directly appeal to the Muslim world? I don't believe so. In the Christian world, we see the future coming of the rapture of the church, and then we recognize the time of Jacob's trouble where attention will be brought on to Israel. They're looking for their Messiah. They're looking for his first advent. They're not looking for God in the flesh, but they're looking for him as a leader like Moses, who can speak the words of God and do the miracles of God. So the earmarks of what they're looking for could be fulfilled in the Antichrist, and will be, because Jesus said, I come in my Father's name, and if you reject him, another will come in his own name, and the people will accept. So the Antichrist is going to be one that Israel's going to see as their Messiah, but also in the Islamic world. They are expecting one that will be unlikely that's going to be present as well. And in his return, some refer to us on the initial faith, but the idea is he will come with the intent of creating a peace agreement and breaking a peace agreement with the whole world, restoring the Jews. And for 40 years, Esau, who was referred to as Jesus of the God, will return with them to Damascus, and they will then lead the world together and eliminate the Jews from the earth. So we can see how this deception, dear lady, could possibly be there for the Muslims, but also there for the Jews.
But Mary, this is the literal meaning right here. Let's go to the Bible, Revelation chapter 6. Verse 2, he said, I behold a white horse. The white horse symbolizes the false lie of the Antichrist crying, peace, peace. White is a symbol of peace. Verse 4, he saw the red horse. The red is symbolic of war. He came in peace, but really he came for war. And then in verse 5, the black horse. Black represents here famine. The famine that will move across much of the world. And then the pale horse is symbolic of death. So all those four horses represent the destruction that will come upon this world because of the Antichrist. Well, thank you so much. All right. Can someone please explain the meaning of the last portion of Jeremiah 31:22? And let's read it here. How long will you go about, O you backsliding daughter? For the Lord has created a new thing in the earth, and this is our question. A woman shall encompass a man. She wants to know what that means. Well, first of all, beginning with verse 18, it's dealing with the rest of the repentance of Israel. And the backsliding daughter is not speaking of a literal woman. It's symbolic for the nation of Israel. And then the statement, a woman shall encompass a man, is what will happen when Israel accepts Jesus Christ as her Messiah. She will encompass him. That's what it means. Any comment, guys?
That's it.
On that particular statement. And you know, a lot of these questions y'all are having.
Yep.
If you had an expositor study Bible, you wouldn't have to call in and you wouldn't have to send an email. You would have the answer right there. Esther from California. You're on the air. Do you have a question or comment today?
Yes, I do. I have a question about starting the lingering of October 7th that went through a lot of pain. And then died. What happens to their children where, because there are a lot of chosen people, they're not, maybe not born again, but they're not chosen people. And I wonder, do they have special grace and mercy, my daughter?
No. No, you've got a wrong thought. Yes, the nation is God's chosen people.
but not in a backslidden state. They're not in fellowship with God. Therefore, does it matter whether you're Jewish, whether you're Muslim, whether you're Baptist, whether you're Methodist, by tradition, if you haven't accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, your soul and spirit goes to hell. And
die
the final attempt of demonic forces to overthrow God. And there will be those in the millennial reign that even though they lived in a perfect environment and they obeyed the laws of God externally, internally they never accepted Him as Lord and Savior. And they will once again throw their lot in with Him, but there will be an immediate dispatching of it all. It won't be a long, drawn-out conflict. Immediately, they will be destroyed. And everyone that is left, there will be those in their glorified body, those in their natural body, and it will be nirvana for eternity. A perfect environment.
Thank you so much. That was so enlightening. I was so curious. Thank you so much.
Thank you. My question is, when you receive the Holy Spirit, do you have to pray for it? I've been told that you have to pray for it, but I was raised to believe that you receive it when you are saved. How do you all feel about that? Well, it's both. There's not a single believer on earth that the moment they got saved, that the Holy Spirit did not come in to live in their heart. But that is the spirit of regeneration. That is not the baptism in the Holy Spirit. The baptism in the Holy Spirit is a distinct and separate work. And you to prove that, let's go to start at the book of Acts. And I'm not going to go through a long dissertation because I want to get every call and every email in today. But go, when the Holy Spirit fell in Acts 2, and they spoke in tongues, if you get it all at salvation, well, explain the disciples. They were there on the day of Pentecost. They had the Holy Spirit because they were saved, but yet they received something separate. That's the infilling of the Holy Spirit. You can go look down as well into Samaria, I think. Look, read down in there what happened there. These people got saved, and then Peter and John sent workers up, were sent back by the early church to pray for them to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And we can go on and on with different examples in that. So, yes, at the moment of salvation, the Holy Spirit comes in. But as I said, that is the spirit of regeneration. And then there is a distinct and separate work of grace for the believer called the infilling of the Holy Spirit. William from Texas, you're there.
Let me just emphasize, those are two separate baptisms. When we get saved, we are baptized into the body of Christ by the Holy Spirit. When we receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, we are baptized into the Holy Spirit by Christ.
Yes.
Two totally separate experiences.
There are three baptisms intended for every person. The first is salvation, baptism into Christ. Second, the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Third, water baptism as a testimony to the world of what Christ has done in our hearts and in our lives. William from Texas, you're on the air.
Good morning, Danny from Texas.
Good morning.
Yes, Tony, I've got a question and then I have a comment I'd like to
hear.
Just tell me about both. First question is Genesis 12:3. I've prayed for the peace of Jerusalem for the last umpteen years. I was taught by a messianic evangelist that we're to do that. And so in light of what our president has done now, that he's withdrawn military support for the offensive part of the IDF, and he said he would just supply defensive weapons for Israel against their people that attack them. And my question is, are we there? Are we getting there real quick to becoming a cursed nation because we've turned our back on Israel?
John, I'll let Josh argue you answer.
Well, I would say this, we are on very dangerous ground, in my opinion. I feel like we are on very dangerous ground. But let's not forget this, though. What we can't discount is that really the support for Israel in our country always has come from, and even when we see it play out, for example, in the White House, it's really started and comes from Christians. And we continue to have at least a remnant. I'm glad that some of us, all of us around this table, fall into that. Christians in this country that do support, in fact, the majority, I would say, of the church world does support Israel and prays for Israel consistently. If we stop, if we forsake that, then I believe is where we're going to really go down that slope, so to speak. But at the same time, the actions that our leadership takes for or against Israel, whether we stand up for her and support her or not, the Lord is paying attention to that. Israel is referred to as the apple of God's eye. This means fruit. It means it's a gradient. It means whenever God looks at a situation in this world, especially regarding nations, he's looking at it through the lens, through the filter of the nation of Israel, the people of Israel, and the Jews. So our nation right now, still, even though we could do a whole lot better, when you look at us relative to the rest of the world, the other members of the UN, for example, we are still standing in solidarity and in support of Israel. We can do a lot better. The last thing I'll say is this. We can stand to stop being just an ally and act as a friend. There's a difference. When you can have two people that totally disagree, but they can align together and put those disagreements aside for one cause. A friend is a whole lot more than that. A friend is someone who actually cares about you. So I feel that if we as a country, as a nation, are not careful, we're going to continue to fall under what can be looked at as a judgment of God. Look, just the lifting of God's hand regarding protection, I view that as a form of judgment. Anything that God does that's not for us is going to hurt. And if the Lord meant what he said, you referenced in Genesis 12:3, bless those that bless you, not curse those that curse you. But I think we can still see the hand of protection and blessing in this country by God. But we're coming close to overstepping. I saw my opinion, Dad, you may call him a different year.
So I hope that answered your question there. And what is your comment?
Before I make my comment, I just want to let you know my girlfriend, Mary Jane, told me about Francis and Friends a month ago, and I started watching it, and I am so blessed.
Well, thank you.
And it's just a great program. I just love your mom. She's so sweet. I get tickled at her when you two get at each other a little bit about what happened. Well, here's my comment, and this is just something that I need you to tell me how far off base I am on this, but I've always been taught that there's several institutions that God set up, the family, civil government, and the church. And I was telling Mary Jane the other day, I said, you know, when I look at the last three Democratic presidents, I look at Bill Clinton, all that went on with him, that is an attack on the family. I mean, Michael Lindsay, Paula Jones, all of them, plus he let couples come in that were not married, and they slept together in the Lincoln bedroom. To me, that's just an attack on the family. The next one was an attack on Christianity. I don't know if y'all remember this or you heard it, but one day a reporter was interviewing Barack Obimbo and said that he had what we call a Freudian slip when the plane was asked. He said, yes, I'm a Muslim. And he retracted it and said he wasn't. And to me, that was an attack on Christianity. We've got a president that's a Muslim. Now, number three, attack on civil government. We got with what happened in the courts with Trump, plus what's happened with our president and the way we, like you said a while ago, in your earlier study, anarchy. We see anarchy taking place now, and anarchy is an attack on civil government. And I just want to know what you think about that.
Well, Republican presidents are guilty of allowing unmarried couples to come into the White House and sleep in the Lincoln bedroom. That's been going on for ages. That's not a new thing. Secondly, there are Republican presidents, and I believe, that have done and enacted policies that are against the Word of God. George Bush, 1 and 2, and they, in spite of the smoke screen, they were not the best friends of Israel at all. So I think it's not a party thing. I think it's just the heart. It's a party thing in the sense of the platform, but the platform can be right, and the person in the office still not be right. But yeah, overall,
teaching, preaching, and anointing music will minister to your heart. So right now, we're passing the altar plan. We're asking to help us make up the shortfall. And for those of you that can help, we want to give you one of Dad's most anointed CDs entitled Homeward Bound. The title song is a great song written by Rusty Goodman. When you begin to listen to it, you're going to be blessed. And secondly, with your gift, we're going to make up the shortfall. So please go to the phones, go online, and help us with the make show.
Jimmy Swagger Bible College, a journey that's taking us to new heights, a journey that's preparing our students for life. Our message remains the same, our vision, to take on new challenges. At JSBC, you're not just choosing a college, you're choosing to walk in faith. Our students are preparing for opportunities. Our students are learning how to resolve challenges life brings. Our students are impacting communities throughout the world. And our professors allow the Holy Spirit to guide them. It's our faith that brings us together, and our love for Christ that strengthens us. If you have a calling to ministry, a desire to study music, or creative passion for media, then JSBC is the place for you. If you are ready to take that next step of faith, then now is the time for you to take this journey with us. Jimmy Swagger Bible College. Spiritually minded, academically sound.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Pastor Gabriel Swagger. He's got a very special preaching, teaching offer that you need to have in your library. There are three of my messages that I've preached for Family Worship Center in the last couple of years. The first one is called The Right to Life. Every Christian conservative needs this. They need to watch it and understand what the Bible says about the subject of abortion. Second one, Say the Word. And last, God's redemption plan. Each one of these messages will be anointed by the Holy Spirit and will be a blessing to each and every single one of you. And here's what we're doing. Every single one of you that orders this particular offer is $40 for all three of these particular combos. However, we're going to throw in a very special bonus. Ryan Haynes' CD, I Found the Living in My Vows. Go to the phone or go online right now.
Millions of Christians live their lives gambling on the goodness and mercy of God. In the book, Eternal Security, evangelist Jimmy Swagger addresses man's free will and power of choice before at mission. Readers will discover the doctrines of many modern-day churches guarantee heaven no matter what, by proclaiming once saved, always saved. To purchase the book, Eternal Security, go to shopjsm.org.
Hello, this is Donnie Swagger, and I'm going to be in Des Moines, Iowa, June the 13th and the 14th. I'll be speaking at the I Stand for Jesus annual statewide crusade. It's going to be on the Iowa State Fairgrounds, 3000 Grand Avenue, there in Des Moines, Iowa. It's going to be a great time, Thursday and Friday night at 7 o'clock. For more information, the phone number's on the screen, the address is on the screen, or you can go to my website, DonnieSwagger.org.
It's the powerful studio album from Family Worship Center Resurrection singer Daryl Whit, Daystar.
Daystar, shine down on me. Let your love shine through me.
Uplifting music that magnifies His glorious name.
available online at sunlifetv.com.
All right, we're back. Genesis 4:1 basically says that Cain was from the Lord, but 1 John 3:12 says that Cain was of that wicked one. Can you shed any light on this? Yeah, it's really simple. In Genesis 4:1, Cain was of the Lord, meaning that birth is of God. What came forth was what God intended will as far as mating and reproducing and bringing forth children. But 1 John 3:12 is after the fact. Okay? After he has done what he has done, murdered his brother, and turned his back on the sacrifice. And so, and by that his actions, by his actions, that showed that he was a son of perdition, if you will, and not a son of God. Any other comments?
Well, he thought when she said, I've got me a man from the Lord, she was really believing that that was Messiah, that he was the one that was promised, and the fact is he wasn't.
But she's only people blanch when you say that, but they have to go back to the Hebrew.
Yes,
and the evidence by many, many Hebraic scholars and Bible theologians that are experts in the Old Covenant, the Old Testament, that idea, I have gotten me a man from the Lord, there is an inkling of thought there in the language itself that, as you said, that when Cain was born, she thought, this is the one that was spoken of in the garden.
Exactly.
And the second the Hebrew scholars bring out when Abel was born, and the statement made that she made about him, I don't remember verbatim what it is, whatever, but it was, there was, in the Hebrew, the emphasis is defeat. In other words,
Abel means penalty. That was the idea, was she referred to the Lord as covenant God, being covenant made in the garden. The one is going to come that you bruise his heel, but he'll bruise your head. Well, they're getting mankind. She thought it was immediate, and by the time that Abel came, and there may have been others in between, but the fact is, the idea she possibly just lost faith.
That's what the scholars say.
That's really the explanation there.
Yes. All right, Kurt from Iowa. Hello. You're on the air. Question or comment?
Hello.
Yes. Yes.
Hey, I think you're going to be in Des Moines here.
Right.
In a couple of weeks.
Yeah.
Do I have to have tickets for
now?
Is there some tickets that you're selling you on?
Yeah.
Just speeding tickets, get there.
Good.
And it's going to be outdoors, so I would say dress comfortably.
Maybe bring a rain suit if it's weather like today.
No, don't say that. That says, we all know what the charges are. The charges are so wide and broad
and that the instructions from the judge to the jury that were so bizarre. I mean, I heard a Democrat legal officer say, he said, this is bizarre. He said, I don't understand any of this. And that's the point I'm making in that. And look, I've been in trials before. I was on a jury before. And let me tell you, I was on a criminal jury, a criminal case. And the man was as guilty as all the evidence was overwhelming. But it took us hours of trying to get across to some jurors who, in spite of the evidence, were intent. They were focused on casting a vote the other way. And that's what happens. And so all of this should have never happened. And it has nothing to do with paying your taxes. It has nothing to do with if the legal system wants to come after you, Kurt, they can and they will. But they can find something.
Look what's happened to some of the people who on January 6th. Some of them not even come to trial. Still in prison for years.
Well, they've got the last time I heard, it was over 200 people, or over 100 maybe, that have not yet been before a judge. They've been sitting in jail. Their rights have been denied. The right of a speedy trial, or to know the charges against you. Not only that, Kurt, but they've been denied doctor's visits. They've been denied access to counsel in some cases. So, with the government, Kurt, if they want you, if they get you in your crosshairs, they're going to get you.
We have been called domestic terrorists.
Christians.
Yeah.
Yeah. But we have to, it's important to know history. And I think one of the most famous quotes that came out of a certain year in history was from Pastor Nemo and in Germany.
Yeah.
He said, when they came for communists, I didn't say anything because I wasn't a communist. They came for the trade unionists, they came for the socialists, I didn't say anything because I was none of those things. They came for the Jews. I wasn't a Jew, so I didn't say anything. When they came for me, there was no one left to speak for me. And we've got to be careful. This isn't an overnight thing. What has happened in this trial is a precedent setter. And it means that they see that it's successful. So the same tactic may be tried yet again.
It even has a name now.
Yeah.
And Kirk, and they're calling it, and I'm not just on that preserving lawfare. Using the law to silence someone of a political dissent that you don't want to hear. To stop the people from hearing.
If you're a business with big gaps,
exactly. So that's the point we're making, Kirk.
You feel that right now they're going to come for me.
Well, they might not come for you if you don't disagree with them.
So we're not trying to incite fear by saying they are coming for you. That's not the definitive statement we're making. We're saying because they've done it to him, the possibility of them coming for us, they can. Because he's a former president, because he literally ran the country for 4 years, and now look what they've done to him. How much more can they do that to just citizens, to just people that they just want to get out of their way?
Those who would stand up. Now, Kurt, if you're going to be one that will say, I don't disagree, I'm not going to be a voice, I'm not going to stand up, I will just be passive and quiet, that's maybe the 15% you disagree with us on, then they're not going to come for you. They're absolutely not going to come for you. But if you will stand up and speak like those that are sitting on this set right now, there's a mark.
Yeah.
That said, when you speak up and speak out, that's what we're talking about.
And most of us couldn't afford an attorney to go through all of the things that we could possibly go through. You've heard of other people that have opposed this government, I'll say that, and look at the thousands, hundreds of thousands of dollars they've had to spend for legal help.
That's why the ACLU has been so successful in our schools, is because they can't afford to fight them off.
Yeah.
Let me get some scripture here that'll help. Of those that are willing to be silent, I place them in a very negative category in my thinking. But it says this in Psalm 94, verse 20. It says, shall the throne of iniquity have fellowship with thee, which frameth mischief but a lie? So they will use the law or make laws for the very purpose of saying, you've broken the law. Then it says they gather themselves together against the soul of the righteous and condemn the innocent blood. But the Lord is my defense, and my God is my refuge. And he shall bring upon them their own iniquity, and shall cut them off in their own wickedness. Yea, the Lord our God shall cut them off. There will come a time that God will deal with these individuals. And these individuals can be dealt with.
Well, just answer, Kirk. Really, I'm going to interrupt. Kirk, in the Old Testament, there were many cases where God raised up a prophet to prophesy against Israel for a particular sin, and that sin was this. Of those